Come to the closer, please. That's it. Right in. Let me have this ear here. Right in here. Just come in a bit closer.
The man being manipulated is David Garth, mastermind of many successful political campaigns. The man doing the manipulating is Harry Benson, a Glaswegian who loves Glasgow but lives in New York. At 54, he is one of the top photojournalists in the world, a status publicly confirmed in 1982 when he was named Magazine Photographer of the Year.
What? I wonder, you do me a favour?
Sure.
Would you come into the picture a second?
Yeah.
Would you, no, say where I'd like you. Like, just like, come down lower, will you do it? Would you do me a favour? Would you just put the cigar in our hand and just put your hand over this, like that, okay. And be talking. Lift it up.
His first job was carrying reels of film between local cinemas. A neighbour expressed amazement to his mother that he had managed to get a job at all, as she had always thought he was daft. Like so many Scottish evaluations of Scottish talent, her assessment has not proved to be definitive.
I like the best about Harry is that he loves his work, and he loves to work more than anything. And he approaches every assignment as if it's the very first one he's ever done for you. And there's nothing like a small assignment for Harry. It doesn't have to be a cover. It can be one picture and a feature. Everything matters to him a great deal. And so you can give him an assignment, hang up the phone, and never worry about it again. And if you're on a weekly like I am, your life is spent worrying, you know, that someone's not going to show up or it isn't going to be right. And Harry, for me, is worry-free, just worry-free. And I also say he's my best Doberman, which is if I have a difficult assignment or a difficult person, I sort of sick Harry on them. And he always comes back with shots. And he always gets people to do things they don't believe they're doing. And he gets them to open up.
The adjective I think I'd use most often to describe Harry would be wily. He really just puts his nose to the ground like a basset hound and follows a story, tracks it almost, and is able to really put his finger on the pulse of a person particularly, and that's important in the case of People magazine, to sense when that person is about to, well, I hesitate to say crack, but reveal what, you know, something about himself that we'd like to capture on film.
He's going to kill me for saying this. Because he said, don't make me look bad. Harry is the kind of man who is vastly insecure about his work. Number one, he's an excellent photographer. He knows his craft to the nth degree, and he exercises it to the nth degree. Whenever he goes out, you always feel that he's going to bring something back. That you know when Harry goes out that he will not come back empty-handed. But when he comes back and he turns his work over to you, the editor, he becomes vastly insecure about it. And his constant harassing you, how have I done? Is it okay? Do you like it? Is it going to work? That's where you usually collide with Harry, saying, get out, let me get through with the edit.
There's an old saying in photojournalism, there are two qualities. It's F8 and be there. Obviously, meaning you know, have to know how to operate a camera, but the most important thing is to get in, to be persuasive enough, to be abusive enough, if it calls for that, to be syrupy, whatever quality, but get in to where the picture, where the story can be done. Harry Benson is an absolute genius at doing that.
I wanted to play for Celtic. I would settle for Rangers. Certainly, I played a trial for Queen's Park. I wanted to play. My ambition was to be a goalkeeper for Scotland. I mean, and that wasn't a childish, you know, that left me, that ambition left me when I was about 32, you know. It stayed with me for a long time, you know.
So being one of the best photographers in the world is a sort of second best for you, isn't it?
Yeah, I like to have, I mean, I think to play for your country, you know, would have been, you know.
Yeah, but there must have been something that, you know, that specifically led you to that. Were you given a camera?
No, I think it was growing up in Glasgow during the war and listening to Churchill's speeches and the drama, wanting to be the centre, wanting to get to the centre of something, whether it was a football match or or something, wanting to be at the center of it.
New York's Central Park looks nice, but it can be dangerous. Harry Benson chooses where and when to walk there with his Texan wife Gigi and their two children. A sense of where to go and when to be there has always been important to him.
I used to walk around and look for spontaneous pictures. This was for the London Daily Sketch. And I was using a great big camera. I mean, it's not like what they use now, whether you can put a 35 millimeter under the arm and do it. I was using a big camera, and so I had to go, I had to sort of back up to these kids and try and catch them. It was a kind of bang. It was only one shot. Kind of, you know, I mean, if you had 10 plates in those days, you had a lot of film.
To develop fully, a photojournalist needs more than a lot of film. He needs events. They are what he feeds on. He must track them and trap them in a camera, using as bait whatever advantages of self or circumstance he can find.
Well, I only heard about them vaguely, you know. I didn't really care about them, and I wasn't that much interested in the music at that time. And there was a photographer from Liverpool was on it. And I remember I went out in London and I met Brian Epstein. He was really, really, really a good guy. And I remember he said to me, well, you'll do, you'll do. And I asked him when I started to cover them, asked him what he meant by this. And he said, well, the one thing, he said, you're not ugly. Anybody that was ugly around the Beatles, God help them. They used to make fun of them. And there was and the photographer who was on it originally, and I have to admit, was ugly. And then I went to Paris, and that was the night they were told they were coming to America. I Want to Hold Your Hand was number one. They would never have come to America at that time if they were number two. Only if they were number one. At least that was the decision they made. So I hung around till about 3 o'clock in the morning and got them having a pillow fight. Now, they did have pillow fights. They did have a lot of kind of, you know, childish sort of violent games, you know, because they're shut up there. And where did they go?
They went to America, where the ultimate arbiters were waiting to make them the most successful pop group in history. Harry Benson not only managed to go with them, he contrived to be the fifth man off the plane. Finding himself at last at the center of things, he wasn't overawed. Surrounded by history as it happened, he grabbed his own small piece of it, catching the moment when what looked like a descent was really an elevation into myth. A myth he saw ways of connecting to other myths in the making.
First of all, we tried to get Sonny Liston, because he was going to win. You understand? Cassius Clay, as he was then, had no chance. No chance at all. So I went to Liston, and Liston didn't want to be taken with the punks. So I went to Ali, and I asked him, and he said, yeah, sure, bring them along. What was clever about Clay then, how he manipulated them. He made them fall, he made them lie on the ground, and he stood over them. And afterwards, the Beatles wouldn't speak to me for days because they said that this guy was not the champion and made them look stupid, made them look like fools, and it was all Harry Benson's fault. You know what I mean?
Well, whose idea was it to have the photograph? Was that his idea that they should lie down?
Yes, that's right. He was prepared for them. We'd all prepared for them, you know, I mean, it was all dressed and shining, there you are. He had them all doing whatever he wanted to do. Clever man.
One clever man was learning from another. Through an accident of circumstances, Harry Benson had picked the right man and learned from a master strategist how to stay close to the center.
I have a dream that one day down in Alabama with its vicious racists, with its governor.
The center of things, he was to find, was often an ugly place to be, requiring nerve and the ability to function coolly in the midst of other people's grief. The brutally abrupt end to the dream of Martin Luther King was such a time.
As sisters and brothers, I have a dream today.
I was in the area, I was near Memphis when he was shot, and I remember going to his hotel room, going straight there, and a guy called Jose Williams let me in, and he was crying, but what he was doing was, he had soaked Martin's blood up with towels and then squeezed it into a jar. So he was crying with this half bottle full of Martin's blood. Anyway, that photograph, that's one of these kind of bizarre things that happen, you know, in your photograph, which were never used. I thought it was going to be used. No one ever used it. I was away from the rest of the photographers when this photograph was taken. They were at one site where they expected the plane to stop, except it turned around to where I was, and the door opened quickly, and it came down, and it was just for a fleeting moment they came together. I believe, and I've heard, that it was Mrs. King. It still is Mrs. King's favorite photograph.
Success breeds access to other historic moments, such as Jimmy Carter towards the end of his presidency, looking like an old Tom Sawyer, wondering where Huckleberry Finn has gone.
Just to be allowed into the room with a president is historic, is an opportunity. And it's not I can't throw it away, it's out of my hands. So I want to take the most of the opportunity. So I'm going to ask the president to move around the room. No, he'd be content just to smoke a pipe and half an hour to do nothing. Marvelous. No. Mr. President, I'd like you to do this, that, this, and that. You say, well, I'll do this and that. Fine. And some people I've seen press secretaries looking at me enough to look, you can't speak to the president like that. But you can.
That continuing refusal to be overawed by public figures has meant that when the big events happen, Harry Benson is ready, traveling light with no cumbersome inhibitions. When the normal transforms itself into the hellish, for him, it's just another subject.
And so the incredible has happened, the grotesque repetition of circumstances within 5 years that has made American political life so tragic and squalid. It was a senseless outrage in Los Angeles today. The shooting of Senator Robert Kennedy is a ghastly imitation of the killing of his brother, John, on that dreadful day in Dallas.
I mean, I remember every detail of it. And it was a very happy situation going into hell. I remember I left the kitchen with Bobby because that was the quickest way out of a place is to leave with a candidate. You know, people make way and you get out, you're out in the street instead of going out with all the public. And I was only about, 3 yards behind him. So I was walking out, then I saw another way of getting out quicker because he was going up to his room. And I turned to go one way, turned away from him, and a girl next to me, a little girl with one of these boaters, screamed. And I remember, I said to myself, this is it. This is it. I never heard any shots. I just started to hear, I just heard the screams. I turned around and Bobby was kind of falling over in sort of slow motion. And I remember saying to myself, this is it. This is it, Harry. Mess up tomorrow, but don't mess up today. Whatever you do, this is it.
Not messing up today meant refusing to be paralyzed by the shock and grief around him. Others might lose themselves in disbelief. He had a job to do. The need to do it pushed him past the barrier even of Ethel Kennedy's grief, to record the horror of what had happened. From initial confusion to forlorn aftermath, to move like a benign vulture around a dying man, regardless of some of the criticism he received, hardly aware of what was happening to himself.
I did get punched about because I had to get into a position. Yeah, I did feel a little bit bad because, you know, a man was dying in front of me, and a man who was always very kind to you. But I did the right thing.
The right thing for a photojournalist is to go to the extremes of our experience and, like the black box in an aeroplane crash, bring back a record of it. Doubtless his achievement at that time has helped to open doors to less taxing assignments. But behind the media charm needed for such photographic sessions, the ability to sniff out the human reality behind the image was undiminished. The Doberman still had all its teeth, though it might be house-trained.
Photographers have got to go on with people. I mean, in order to get so-and-so or Farrah Fawcett, who's a lovely lady, to do things, you have to go on with them. You have to be nice. You can't go in there like a Nazi and be nasty with people. But they won't do anything for you, so you've really got to be a nice, friendly, nice, not soft, because people will take advantage of you if you're soft, you know, but you have to go on with people, you know, but if they step out of line, whoever said I was a friend? I always wanted to get to photograph Greta Garbo because she's like Howard Hughes, or Sir John Ellerman used to be. It was, you know, she's a recluse, it fascinates me, you know, people that go to all this extent of being invisible, you know. I mean, okay, people say, well, they deserve to have their privacy, but if that's what they wanted in life, they shouldn't have sought it in the first place. So they can't expect to turn that the hounds, the dogs are going to stop being interested in you just because you say, wait a minute, I've got people who are interested in you, you know. So anyway, she went for a She just came floating by. She just came out to the boat and looked up. I read about this in a Long Island newspaper about Jackie Kennedy's relatives, aunts, being in poverty in Southampton. So I went up there. I thought, that's interesting. I went up there, and after a long time, they let me into the house. There was an old lady upstairs. I'd never seen mess. It was heaped high with dirt and raccoons. And I'd never seen anything like it in all my life. I remember she said to her daughter, Edith, she said, this place is a disgrace. And Monday morning, I insist, you start dusting. There were raccoons and wild animals. It was heaped high with garbage. I said, yeah, you better do it. She's my mother, gives me a lot of trouble. I think we're going to miss Truman. I am. I mean, he was a strange little man, everybody knows, but he was a hard, hard man. Looks can be deceiving. It wasn't fooling me anyway. This was a hard little man. He's a funny little voice, but he was tough. And it's one of these characters that go into your life and you feel better that you've met him. You know, you've got something from him. He gave you plenty.
I, Richard Nixon, do solemnly swear. I, Richard Nixon, do solemnly swear. I will faithfully execute the office of President.
That determination to worry appearances down to some bone of reality admits of no exceptions, neither status nor acquaintanceship afford protection from it. When Watergate went public, Harry Benson's knowledge of some of the participants provided him with his own angles on it, notably when John Mitchell was acquitted of complicity in the scandal.
What happened was that I had a few years before that, I photographed Martha Mitchell with him for a story, but mainly his wife Martha, for a life essay. So I knew him, and I knew he likes to have a drink. Also knew him to be a very, you know, he was a nice man, you know, he was. So anyway, I waited, other photographers had done the stuff and waited downstairs for about an hour, went upstairs, and sure enough, John Mitchell's having a good time. He said, come in, nice to see you. And he knew I was Scottish, and he sang Harry a lot of songs. Keep right on to the, I've got a stick here. That's where I took the photograph. It was knowing John Mitchell and knowing he's quite an emotional man. You know your victim.
In all the decisions I have made in my public life, I have always tried to do what was best for the nation.
Throughout the long and difficult period of Watergate, I have felt it was my duty to persevere, to make every possible effort to complete the term of office to which you elected me. In the past few days, however,
President Nixon's credibility had been in doubt long before Watergate. This meant that not Nixon himself, but his wife Pat, was perhaps the most interesting victim of his resignation.
Well, there were some awful things said about Pat Nixon, like she was, they called her the plastic lady, and they called her cold as ice. But I'd worked around the Nixon White House a lot, and I knew this was not so. She is a very emotional lady. I had the feeling that she would cry over this. I waited until he started to speak, and then I moved away from the other photographers, because if I moved before, they would have moved with me. But I moved so that I could get him and her in the same. I knew that she couldn't take much of this, you know, and her eyes just began to water. Any minute I just expected her just to collapse.
Access to high places hasn't softened his hard preparedness to put himself at risk, even in occupied Afghanistan, always taking with them his awareness of human vanity, like a passport.
Now that's another advantage that a photographer's got, is to be able to, that people like to show off. They don't want to pass this way unnoticed, regardless of what they may do. But it does help to have Life magazine in your back pocket. I'm not under any illusion that, I mean, I see how far I would get would be Harry Benson phoning up the president, can I come and photograph you next Tuesday? Is he crazy? Who are we kidding, you know? And I think that is with every photographer, you know.
But then Harry Benson isn't every photographer. Success doesn't seem to have mellowed him significantly. He remains still as much of a natural outsider as one of his favorite people, Bobby Fischer.
Dear Bobby, I think he's one of the five characters in my life who's really had an effect. I'm glad I met. I mean, you could say that he is a genius. Spassky didn't have a chance. I remember coming back with him one day, and he got beaten. Spassky beat him. I said, well, that was tough, da 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 da. I know nothing about chess. And he said, what do you know about it? Don't patronize me. He says, tomorrow I'll crush him.
The same unblinking sense of purpose is part of Harry Benson's nature. The same determination to put people where he wants them.
What is it?
Can you say balls in Scotland?
Photographing Richard Belzer, a New York Jewish comedian, he is the man in control. He even makes the jokes, which are perhaps a camouflage.
Sure this is going to help my career?
Oh. Help me, help mine.
All right, I'll do it for you. Because I like you.
Do you dislike quite a few?
I usually dislike everybody I photograph. I usually go in there, I'm usually angry every time I take a photograph. I know this goes back to my background. People don't know I'm angry. But I find this a much safer position to be in as angry than complacent and happy. I'm watching them like a hawk, you know. I didn't mean to say my pictures are going to be any... I'm going to pull it off. But if you are, what can I say? You know, if you're angry, you're concentrating. I'm going to do a much better job.
Do you mind if I come in the picture, do you?
Who?
These Lawn and Hardy dolls here.
Yeah,
oh,
sure.
Yeah. Well,
that's
you want.
A great idea.
Please,
I'm your subject.
Pass them over, Bob. I like to just be holding it. Nice. I like them.
Yeah, they're comedy, yeah. Too. And see the Groucho? Yeah, take that.
That's Charlie Chaplin.
Yeah. Yes. And the Groucho.
No, the Groucho will fall out, could break.
I'd rather bore them for 5 minutes than have inspiration flying into Kennedy Airport. Why didn't I do this? That's awful. That's worse, much worse. I didn't do my job. I was manipulated by someone who, if I see at a party the following night, will not recognize me. And a lot of photographers and journalists forget this. They think, oh, he was so nice, I had coffee. But did you get a story? Did you get pictures? Did he use it? Well, no, but it's good for background. They didn't use it. No, I don't like leaving them, and, you know, I'm going to get my pound of flesh. This is my business. This is my life. You know, who are these people? We keep them in business. We keep their image alive. And my pound of flesh is, could be Willie Nelson in a bathtub. It could be Farrah Fawcett lying on this floor. But they're all, they come out very well on this. I got what I wanted out of them. If I had gone along with what their public relations people would want, it would be awful, and they wouldn't have had a cover in life. Do you follow my point? Yeah.
The Glasgow Doberman has come a long way. He may be sleek with success, and he may share moments with the famous, but don't let the company fool you, or the fact that he owns Harry Lauder's curly walking stick. He belongs to an alternative Scottish tradition, one that has found no great cultural shock in moving from Glasgow to New York, those twin cities of abrasive friendliness. He's still as independently alone as the goalkeeper he wanted to be, seeing that not much gets past him.
You probably won't like my saying this, but I think that is one of his strengths, is that he sees himself outside the general spectrum. And it's lonely being an outsider, but he uses that to his advantage. And it gives him an ability to... he's a great observer, you see. Great photographers should be just that, great observers, and not necessarily participants. And I think Harry truly understands that.
There is this Fleet Street hunger about Harry that I think it gives him a competitiveness that a lot of young photojournalists, I think, lack.
He has a very sort of childlike superstition about his work, about his ability to get the next job. And although he's a premier photographer in the photojournalistic sense, he has that doubt that he won't do it so well the next time around.
He is difficult. He knows what he wants. He's going to get it. And everybody else is just going to have to fend for himself. And, you know, that's fine. He gets the picture, and that's what we're there to do.
Here, you've reached a certain standard. I'm not going to be coy about it and start saying, oh, no, I'm, you know. I'd like my father, if he was alive, to see this. All the people who are smarter, who are cleverer at me in my class, I hope they're watching.